Now, we're deep into Matthew. We're in about the middle of chapter 7. But in Matthew chapter 6, in the last half of Matthew 6, Jesus commands the disciples not to fall into the trap of serving money and things rather than God. He commands them not to fall into that. And it's because we're to maintain a proper perspective on material things that we must not be anxious about, fret about. You see, be obsessed over securing even necessities like food and clothing. We must make God the priority and focus of our lives rather than securing even physical necessities. God is the one who provides, and His provision is unrelated to worry. So He tells them, look, you can't be focused on that and obsessed with that and wrapped up in securing those things. I'm the one who provides, and I do that without regard to worry. So leave that to me, and you focus on me. You focus on serving and giving your life to me rather than being wrapped up in securing and acquiring even things as important as food and clothing. Then in chapter 7, verses 1 to 5, he warns of the danger of playing the judge, judging inconsistently or contrary to the will of God. We can be tempted to do that. See, as we lead these kingdom lives, as Jesus in this sermon has been calling us to live these kingdom lives, these righteous lives, we can be tempted to play the judge. Specifically, we can be tempted to substitute our judgments for God's judgment by refusing to accept those He has forgiven when they don't meet our standard of being forgiveness worthy. Can you see how that would happen? That the more I'm transformed and the more that I become like Christ, it is easy for me to fall into this idea, you cannot forgive somebody like that. You see, that's too, and that's the elder brother. That's the elder brother in Luke 15, because here he was, I've always been here doing these things. This brother who went off and was living this way, nah, that's no good. You can't receive him back like that. See, so one of the ways that we can play the judge is we can reject God's judgment about forgiving people who don't meet our standard of being forgiveness worthy. And another way is that we can begin to equate our personal standards with those of God and condemn those who violate our personal standard. In other words, we're holy and we start to fuse our judgments with God's. And so then somebody goes against our personal view, our personal standard, and we then reject them and condemn them. Well, if we judge by our own standards in the sense of pronouncing judgment on those God has forgiven, He will treat us accordingly. With the measure we use, it'll be measured to us. He'll treat us accordingly by pronouncing judgment on us, by refusing to extend mercy to us. And if we judge by our own standards in the sense of pronouncing judgment on those who merely violate our personal standards, God will treat us accordingly by pronouncing judgment on us for violating His standards. So that's what I think is going on there. Then in chapter 7, verse 6, we're told that we need to be wise and discriminating in our dealings with the world. Because, you know, we're to love all people. We're not to be condemning contrary to God's will. And so he reminds us that's true, but we still must make judgments about people. We're to be wise and discriminating in our dealings with the world. When we can recognize that our offering of the valuable and sacred, specifically the message about the kingdom of God, when we can recognize that our doing that will be contemptuously and viciously rejected, well, then we're to shake the dust off our feet. See, which means that we are to leave these people to their hard-heartedness. Now, in light of the radical righteousness to which Jesus calls disciples, as we've gone through, all the way from the Beatitudes through, in light of this radical righteousness that he calls disciples to, calls kingdom participants to, he assures us in chapter 7, verses 7 through 11, that God will grant us the transformation for which we pray in faith. And that's something we need, because when you hear what he's calling us to do, the people he's calling us to be, it is so contrary to our fallenness that we can really be intimidated. And he then says, God will provide. And he calls us then to pray for this transformation. Now, until the consummation, until Christ's return, there's always going to be an aspect, a not yet aspect to our discipleship. We will not be fully sanctified, fully like Christ, until the consummation. So our transformation will never be complete. We will not until that day, until the consummation, until Christ's return, be fully like Him. We will not reach the perfection of God that Jesus calls us to. But we pray for the transforming work, and we will be more like Christ with the prayer for transformation than we would be without it. So we are to pray for transformation, understanding that it won't be complete until that day. All right, in view of that available power, this is all just kind of picking back up. I always like to go back and kind of pick back up where the flow of thought is, where the sermon is. In view of that available power that God will give us, He will provide this transforming work in our lives. Jesus in chapter 7, verse 12, He renews in summary form. He renews in summary form His exhortation to kingdom living. He says, so, He's just talking about the power of God available in prayer. God is, you know, if worldly fathers give good gifts to their children, you can be sure that God is going to bless you and give good gifts to you. Then He says, so whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. He renews this exhortation to kingdom living. This time He does it in terms of the principle that captures the essence of the Old Testament's ethical direction. Now this principle you know well, it's commonly called the Golden Rule. It summarizes kingdom living in personal relationships. It's the Old Testament's ethics mediated to us by Jesus, by the fulfiller of the Old Testament. And this is this summary principle of these Old Testament ethics. It's another way of saying that Christians are to love all people. We are to love all people, in that we are to seek the welfare of others. You see, this is what love is. This is love with skin on it. We are to seek the welfare of other people. We are to seek to do the same good to them, to give the same blessing to them, to benefit their welfare that we would want done for us. This is what Paul calls in 1 Corinthians 9:21, the law of Christ. Christian ethics, the bullseye of Christian ethics is love. That is the center. And things radiate out from that. And you see Paul also using that terminology in Galatians 6:2, read with Galatians 5:14. Now the fact this principle of do unto others as you would have them do to you, the fact that this principle is a summary of the Old Testament's ethical direction, it means that it cannot be interpreted, it cannot be twisted to endorse actions contrary to the revealed will of God. Because it's a summary of the Old Testament's ethical direction. That's why Jesus says, for this is the law and the prophets. He is the Old Testament fulfiller, is giving us the summary of the Old Testament's ethical direction in terms of our personal relationships. So it cannot be interpreted. It can't then be interpreted to endorse actions contrary to God's revealed will. For example, you don't ask what you would want others to do for you if you were a thief, and then reason from that sinful perspective. Well, if I was a thief, what would I want done for me? I'd want them to leave the doors open. I'd want them to praise my skill at stealing. Okay, you can't work it that way. But people say, well, you know, thief would want you. All right, they do that kind of stuff. Douglas Wilson, he recently made the point I'm trying to make here. He said, well, how would you feel if you were a guard at Auschwitz and somebody came and took away all your prisoners, Okay, that's not how this principle is intended to be applied. And I think we generally understand that. Now, in light of the power that's available for kingdom living that he talked about in chapter 7, verses 7 through 11, the power that he referred to there, we need to live this out. See, we need to live this out. We need to be this kind of people who love other people and are desirous of their blessing and their welfare. That doesn't mean that people will always recognize that. There are some times when you tell somebody something that's good for them, your motivation is to bless them and help them, and they don't want to hear it. Okay, I understand that. But our heart is to be, I want what is best for you, just as I would want you to want what is best for me. So that's something. Now we get down to the conclusion, really, of the sermon. The conclusion will go on for a while, but we get down to the conclusion. Jesus is going to call people to a decision. He's preached some incredible things. And now he's going to, we might even call this an invitation. You see, in our terminology. But he's going to call people to a decision. He says in Matthew 7, 13 and 14, enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. I remember when I first read through the New Testament, you know, I was a product of our culture and all this stuff, thought I knew something about the Bible. Hadn't read it, but I kind of thought I had absorbed it somehow. That's how many people are. Oh, no, I know the Bible. I know the Bible. And when I ran across this kind of thing here, I'm saying, whoa, this is not what the culture's telling me. I said, Jesus is pretty clear about some things, and this is not what the culture's telling me. Now, having fleshed out in this sermon the nature of kingdom living, the radical righteousness to which disciples are called, a righteousness that exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, Jesus tells his hearers to enter through the narrow gate. Now, the reason he says that, he says, enter through the narrow gate for, why should I enter through the narrow gate? You should enter through the narrow gate for, because there are only two choices. You should enter through the narrow gate because there are only two choices, and the alternative is not good. The alternative is not good. You see, there are only the two choices. The broad gate, that alternative, is the gateway to destruction. It is the path to condemnation. It is the road to hell. Now, you say that to, you can't say that. You can't talk. Jesus is talking about it. Jesus spoke more about this than anybody. So how do we get so pious that we can look down on Jesus speaking about, oh, that's where he went wrong. He shouldn't have said that. That will frighten people. Does not the Lord know how to reach people and how to talk to people? Yes. And he's saying there are only two choices. Choose the narrow gate because the alternative leads to destruction. It's that serious. It's that important. It's the narrow gate, on the other hand, is the gateway to eternal life in the consummated kingdom. You see, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. This life in the consummated kingdom, when Jesus returns and creation gets the ultimate makeover, and you and I live as resurrected persons in that perfect reality, the divine utopia, that reality in which there's no suffering, sorrow, pain, mourning, crying, any of that. All that is negative and bad, all of the ugly consequences of sin that invaded this creation have been stripped out. It is perfect existence. That's where that road leads. And on the other hand, the broad gate and the broad road lead to damnation. So he says, choose the narrow gate. Enter through the narrow gate. Now, the narrow gate is Jesus Christ. He says in John chapter 10, verse 9, I am the door. Gate, door, he's the entry point. He says here, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. You see, the pasture, this is a symbol of what? Blessing. You get to go in and you get good stuff, and you come out, get you free access just going in and out, you see. So he is the door. The gate is Jesus Christ. And he's a narrow gate. He's a narrow gate, you see, not only because the allegiance that is owed to him cannot be shared with others. He doesn't become one member of a pantheon. So I've got him, and I've got Buddha, and I've got Muhammad, and I've got a really wide gate. The gate is narrow not only because the allegiance that's due him cannot be shared, but also because the life that follows from faith in him, a life of discipleship, is restrictive compared to the broad way of life of those who do not call him master. He is narrow in that he is exclusive. What is owed to him and the allegiance owed to him cannot be shared with others. But also the life that flows out of that gate is itself narrow and restrictive compared to the life of those who don't call him master. John Stott, he explains the two roads and the two associated gates this way in his commentary on the Sermon on the Mount. He says, one way is easy. There's plenty of room on it for diversity of opinions and laxity of morals. It is the road of tolerance and permissiveness. It has no curbs, no boundaries of either thought or conduct. Travelers on this road follow their own inclinations. That is, the desires of the human heart in its fallenness. How many times have you heard it now, follow your heart? Just be true to yourself. That's a way of saying, do whatever you want to do. If you feel the impulse, well, then it's somehow sanctified. I got news for you. That's not the way to go. I live in here. This idea that you can simply follow, well, that's what I want. No. This has to be trained and disciplined. And he says, the human heart has fallen into superficiality, self-love, hypocrisy, mechanical religion, false ambition, censoriousness. These things do not have to be learned or cultivated. Effort is needed to resist them. No effort is required to practice them. That's why the broad road is easy. You have in our society this notion that if I have an impulse and if it's deeply embedded, then somehow it's right and noble for me to act on that impulse. I say, where did anybody get this idea? Where did this idea come from that because I have something that's deep-seated in me, therefore acting on it is correct? I just talked to the guys. I'll talk to the guys now. Guys, do you have any impulses in you that have to be strangled? Or do you say, well, I have this kind of impulse in me. I think I'll just go with it. Why? It's deep. As long as I can remember, I found certain figures attractive. That's just part of who I am. Okay, well, what do you do with that? You don't just sit here and say it's sanctified, whatever I want to pursue in that. And you can multiply the examples, but it's just something that is there in our society, and it's wrong. You see, it is wrong, this notion that, what you know, follow your heart and this kind of thing. That's a lie right out of hell, but you ask most people, oh, yeah, that's right, that's what I want to do. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he was a young German theologian. He was a Lutheran. He was a pastor and a seminary professor. He was executed by the Nazis, and he wrote in his book, The Cost of Discipleship, this is a quote that both Terry and I enjoy. He said, cheap grace is the grace we bestow on ourselves. What does he mean by cheap grace? It's the idea that God is simply this big sin cleanser in the sky, and that discipleship doesn't mean surrender. It just means I believe certain abstract things. I continue to sit on the throne of my life and live the way I want to live. And I get the bennies of this. Well, this is not biblical. But it's the kind of religion that we create because it's the kind we want. But it's not biblical. It's not Christianity. But he says, cheap grace is the grace we bestow on ourselves. Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance. Baptism without church discipline. Oh, we need to hear that. Communion without confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship. Grace without the cross. Grace without Jesus Christ living and incarnate. Costly grace is the kingly rule of Christ. for whose sake a man will pluck out the eye which causes him to stumble. It is the call of Jesus Christ at which the disciple leaves his nets and follows him. This is what the call of Jesus is. It's not simply abstract, oh, I believe that's true. It is, I believe that's true, and I surrender my life in accordance with that belief. I've said many times, Luke 6:46, Jesus says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? He's saying anyone can vocalize that if it is not true. If you don't really mean I am Lord, it is worthless. And if you mean I'm Lord, well, then I'm Lord. You're going to act that way, right? You've called me Lord. You're going to act that way. Now, the path of discipleship, this path is constricted or difficult, which explains its relative paucity of travelers. But it leads to the glory of life in the consummated kingdom. See, it's restricted. It's difficult. This is what he says. The gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. But where it leads to that glorious eternal existence with God. Now, the way is hard in that it requires restraint. It requires discipline. It requires self-denial. But by the way, those who embrace that way, those who make that surrender, those who give themselves to Jesus and say, you're Lord and I'm going to follow you, well, they find what? They find that the Lord's yoke is easy and his burden is light. But as you look objectively, you say, well, look, compared to this big broad road where I'm on the throne and I'm doing everything, what is this road? This is a road of discipleship that calls you to the radical righteousness that he's been spelling out. So you and I don't have the privilege of just saying, well, I don't care. I wanted to do that. I live that way. So what? No, you and I, our life is a struggle to conform to Jesus. And so in fact, somebody points out and say, well, you know, look at you. You're not. I understand that. I understand that we're all a long way from the Lord and we're all on a journey, but that is a different thing than saying, I don't care about the journey. We are all helping one another focus on transformation, on becoming more and more like Jesus. And so we are self-denial, not go with your heart, do whatever impulse you have. No, conforming to Jesus. My Lord who bought me calls me to live this way and I'm going to live that way. Do I do that perfectly? No. But what do you do when you fail? Get up, focus, and keep walking. Okay, that's different, isn't it? Than somebody who says, I don't really care. And you'll see that Jesus brings that up. So you have this idea. It's discipleship is constricted and difficult. So it has relatively few travelers. But the alternative is easy. And it's superficially appealing, which explains its relative popularity, but it leads to what? Damnation. It is a fool's choice. Here I'm sitting here, all this glitter stuff and all that over here. It's like you say, here, you want to come this road? What is this road? This is a road of discipleship. This is a road where you're going to live out however many days God gives you, striving to conform to the image of his Son. You're going to deny yourself. You're going to walk this way. You're going to grab yourself when you fail. You're going to get up and keep walking toward his image. That's this road. Now this road over here, baby, it's party time. You do whatever you want. Live however you want. No rules, nothing, no desire. You just do whatever you want. Okay, well, that's all the little glitter. And where does that road lead? It is a fool's choice because that road leads to damnation. This road leads to eternal life. And that's what Jesus is saying there. Now, this, by the way, alone is sufficient to disprove the myth that is prevalent in our culture that God is not going to condemn anyone and certainly not going to condemn a significant number of people. What is he saying? Those who enter by the braces, there are many. So does it shock us that the world looks at you and says, well, you know, you got a problem. You know, you're an uptight pinhead. You know, you're this and you're that. And you got many, many people saying, oh, you know, these people just are uptight. They don't know what they're doing and this kind of thing. All right, well, it shouldn't surprise us that who's on the broad road? A lot of people on the broad road. And you come in saying, no, this is the way to go. And there are voices over here saying, are you kidding me? You go this way and you're not going to be sleeping with your girlfriend. You're not going to be doing this. You're not going to be doing that. Come on. You're going to be helping these people. You're going to be serving doing this. And over here, I get to be God. I get to live however I want. Okay. You see. So broad. A lot of people are going to be on that. But he says, many there. And he says, the gate's narrow. And those who find it are few. Relatively speaking. Few. Okay, so this notion that God, no, God's a God of love, and he will condemn people. He is going to condemn people. I don't do people a favor by trying to conceal that and lie to them about it. I say, don't worry about it. Don't worry. If it makes you feel bad, I won't tell you the truth that there is going to be a judgment that will have eternal consequences, because that may scare you off. Okay, I'm not doing you any favors that way. Ultimately, you're going to have to hear it. Ultimately, you'll have to hear it. Okay, quick check of the clock. All right, 7:15 to 23. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You'll recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but a diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. That just seems so plain to me. Does that mean perfectly? Does that mean you're going to live sinlessly? Does that mean you're going to earn your way to hell? No, no, no. But it means something. It means I cannot live as though I'm God of my life. Okay. He says, we'll enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. I never knew you. We never had a relationship. Depart from me. Who? You workers of lawlessness. You workers of lawlessness. Okay, Jesus now warns them in this sermon. He's made this call and he's told them that the road is narrow. It is a call of discipleship. I have been painting for you what is required in this discipleship. What does it mean to follow me? It doesn't mean simply thinking these things. It means giving your life to me and coming, follow me as a disciple. And he says that involves all of these very deep, deep things that I am seeking to transform in your life. I love you too much to leave you the way I found you. I am calling you to come and be transformed. So he tells them that, and now he warns them about false prophets who come in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ferocious or ravenous wolves. And in light of what he just said, I believe he's specifically warning them about libertines or antinomians, those who come denying that the road to life is narrow. Those who come claiming in God's name that the path of discipleship is not morally restrictive, but is a broad road that allows one to ignore Christ's high ethical call and to live just like the world. You say, well, who would ever say that? Oh, they say it. They say it now. They said it then. How could that be? Oh, it is. There are plenty of people who preach and teach this kind of stuff, subtly and overtly. Now, false prophets are those who deceive people by teaching error in God's name. Matthew 24:11. Jesus warns that false prophets will deceive many. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, John refers to those allegedly Christian teachers who in some sense denied the incarnation and who were morally indifferent. He refers to them as false prophets. And Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, he speaks of false teachers as latter-day expressions of Israel's false prophets. So you clearly have this going on. Now, these deceivers, they appear to be one of the flock. See, they come there. What are they? They're in sheep's clothing. And Terry's got a great picture that I didn't hunt up of this wolf with this sheep's clothing on. You see that? So they appear to be one of us because they have some beliefs in common with the flock, right? They come right in. They appear to be one of us. They share these ideas. They share some beliefs. On the surface, they look that way. That's what gives them access to the flock, and that's what makes them so dangerous. Paul, in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13, he speaks of deceitful workmen who disguise themselves as apostles of Christ. Well, who are they? Well, they're deceitful workmen. Well, what are they doing? Are they coming in saying, hey, I'm a heretic. Listen up. Heretics never do that. I've told you this many times. They never do that. They always come in saying, I have a deeper view. I have a more enlightened view. That's how they gain at, oh, wow, let me hear this. You see, so Paul says that in 2 Corinthians 11, 13. Jude verse 4 speaks of those designated for condemnation who had slipped stealthily into the community of faith. They're designated for condemnation. They're not Christians. But what are they doing? They've slipped into the community of faith, so they're among them. Well, they're in sheep's clothing. You see, they're in sheep's clothing. They look like one of us. You see the battle with false teachers. It is fought throughout the New Testament. You can't read the New Testament without recognizing it. I just gave some examples in these texts where it is obvious and apparent that they're dealing with false teachers, and they come in different stripes and flavors. You've got the Colossian heretics, you've got the Judaizers, you've got all different kinds. But they're here, and what are they doing? They're trying to pull people away from the faith. And though they appear to be sheep, to be one of us, they're really, he says, ravenous wolves. See, they're ferocious wolves. They're not merely an annoyance. They are spiritually deadly. They are spiritually destructive. We get the idea, well, theology, who cares? Doctrine, who cares? Give me about 2 points, let somebody agree with that, and then I don't care. All right, that's insane. Okay? There are doctrines and truths that must be embraced, and there are people that come and teach against them. A Christian can lose his or her soul by following a false teacher. For example, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 and 2. Now I make known to you, brothers, the gospel which I preached you, which also you received, and which also you stand, through which also you are saved. That is, with what word I preached you, if you hold firm. Well, why wouldn't I? Because there are voices that are trying to pull you from holding firm. Trying to convince you that what I told you is not true. You see here in Galatians 5, 2 and 4. Listen, I, Paul, say to you, if you get circumcised, these are the Judaizers. Christ will be of no benefit to you at all. So he's writing to the Christians there, and he says, if you swallow what the Judaizers are selling as represented by your going ahead and getting circumcised Gentiles under the idea that that's necessary for life with God, if you bring yourself under the Mosaic law in the sense that that is necessary for life with God, he says what? Christ will be of no benefit to you. And I testify again to every man who gets circumcised that he's a debtor to obey the whole law. You who seek to be pronounced righteous by the law, you have been what? Alienated from Christ. Well, is this significant? Is this important? Yes. He goes on and says, you've fallen away from grace. 2 Timothy 2:15, 18. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved and unashamed workman who correctly handles the word of truth. Avoid godless chatter, for those who engage in it will progress further in ungodliness, and their word will spread like what? Gangrene. Rot. Decay. Death. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who deviated from the truth, saying that the resurrection had already occurred, and what? So are ruining the faith of some. Well, is that an important thing? Yes. It's very important. 2 Peter 2:17, he says, these men are waterless springs and mist driven by a storm for whom the gloom of darkness has been reserved. You see here, Peter says, look, you've got the gloom of darkness reserved for these people. For while uttering high-sounding words of nonsense, what do? They entice with lusts of the flesh, acts of licentiousness, those who are barely escaping from those who live in error. What are they doing? They're telling them, listen, don't listen to this narrow road junk. Don't listen to self-denial and self-discipline and living as a disciple and crucifying yourself. Who wants that? I've got the alternative, and it's really enlightened. And by the way, it lets you live how you want. Have sex with anybody. See? Woo! People popping up going, oh, wow. And they're going, really? You mean I can have God and I can be God? I can do whatever I want. I can give vent to any impulse that I have. Yeah. That's what I'm telling you. Do you not see the demonic in this? You see, he says, promising them freedom while themselves being slaves of corruption. For by what someone has been overcome to this, he's been become enslaved. For if after escaping the pollutions of the world by the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they're overcome by again becoming entangled in these things, the last state has become worse for them than the first. For it was better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after knowing it to turn from the holy commandment that had been passed on to them. He's saying, listen, these people are even less, they're worse off. Is that second bill? First, all right. So he winds up, okay, so they had become Christians. They'd been pulled into this lawless living and thinking that sexual immorality is perfectly fine. And he says they're left like this. Of them, he says, it has happened to them according to the true proverb. A dog returns to its own vomit and a sow after being washed to wallowing in the mud. Okay, what I'm showing you is to show you that doctrine is important. We can't just sit here and say, the world's not about doctrine. Young people don't want to hear about doctrine. You know, all they want to care about is, can I go build a house for somebody? All right, all well and good. By the way, if you're thinking about good works, you know, there is a slaughter of babies going on in this world. Give some attention to that. It is a really good thing. Okay? But you sit and say, but you can't say that. Doctrine and truth are important. Well, I don't want to have to learn that. Well, listen, you're a disciple. You see, you've chosen a road of life. 1 John 2, 22-26. Who's the liar except the one who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This one is the Antichrist, the one who denies the Father and the Son. Everyone who denies the Son also does not have the Father. The one who confesses the Son has the Father also. Let what you heard in him from the beginning abide in you. If what you heard from the beginning abides in you, you also will abide in the Son and the Father. This is the promise which he made to us, eternal life. I write these things concerning the ones who would deceive you. Do you mean there are people trying to deceive them, to pull them away? Yes, always. Does that surprise you? We have a spiritual enemy. He is very clever. Does it surprise you that there will be all kinds of voices in the religious world pulling you, saying, this is the truth, this is the truth? It shouldn't surprise us at all. We get here 2 John 7:9. For many deceivers have gone out into the world who do not confess Jesus coming in the flesh. This one is the deceiver and the Antichrist. Watch yourselves so that you do not lose the things for which we worked, but receive a full reward. Everyone who goes ahead and does not continue in the teaching of Christ does not have God. The one who continues in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. You see the danger. That's what I'm trying to portray for you, is the danger. This is why elders have to be skillful in teaching. 1 Timothy 3:2 and Titus 1:9. They have to be able to protect the flock from heresy. If they aren't grounded theologically, if they don't know Christian doctrine, they can't spot heresy. And they have to be able to spot heresy because they have to protect the flock they shepherd from it with no apologies. They have to protect the flock they shepherd from it. By analogy to Timothy, this same holds true for preachers/teachers. You see Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15 and 2:24. And by the way, the fact elders and teachers, preachers have this responsibility does not, of course, relieve Christians of their personal responsibility. Right? They have a responsibility, but so do we. Now, I'm trying to say fast because I at least want to get out this next point. This doesn't mean that every wrong belief or practice puts one's salvation in jeopardy. There are things that are central and clear enough that do that. I've just shown you some of the kinds of things. So it's not like when you say, well, who cares about doctrine? But you can't jump from that then to say that every belief, every wrong belief or practice puts one in jeopardy. No aspect of God's will is trivial. No aspect of his will is trivial. And no aspect of his will can be willfully ignored. Where I say, okay, I understand that's what the Lord wants, but I don't care. Okay? No aspect is trivial. No aspect can be willfully ignored. But not every aspect of God's will is revealed clearly enough or is central enough to make a misunderstanding a matter of salvation. Now, there are difficulties in applying this, of course. There are difficulties, and it often is not clear what belongs in what category. I understand that. But that's better, you see. I think that's much better. Those difficulties are less daunting than the alternative of saying you have to be theologically perfect or you're lost. I'm telling you, I've done the best I can for decades of my life trying to understand the will of God. I've tried as best I'm able. But I am certain that I believe things to be true that I will discover are not. Now, why do I think that? I think that because I have seen the complexity of some of the questions. I've seen the balancing of some of the evidence, the difficulty of discerning some of these things. And I have, in fact, changed my mind on theological matters through the years. So what do I then say? When I changed, I was lost then, or I'm lost now? And let me just leave you with this. Look, if we cannot expect moral and ethical perfection in the here and now, on the way to the consummation, if during this overlap of ages, I cannot expect to be morally and ethically perfect because I'm still subject to the now. You see, I'm still subject to the now and the fallenness and all of this. If I cannot expect complete full sanctification in terms of morals and ethics, why can I think that that my salvation is going to depend on theological perfection? It just can't be. It just can't be. And so we have to be able to work on what are the things that are important that have to be enforced, and people have to be stopped from saying, and people have to be disfellowshipped. And what are these other things that we have to tolerate in one another as you and I grope? All right, well, that's difficult. See, that's why elders also need to be wise. Thanks for coming.